brought to you by Penguin.
The Other Mother by Jen Brister. Read by Jen Brister. For my mum, for everything. In memory of Will Houghton, we miss you. You'll always be a role model to our boys. Prologue. Whatever you do, don't panic. It wasn't my first panic attack, but just like the previous episodes, I had no idea what was happening to me. I only knew that I was about to die on a cobbled street in Edinburgh on a rainy summer's afternoon. I was slap bang in the middle of every comedian's most traumatic month. It was August and the Edinburgh Festival. In that moment, as I sat hunched on my knees in a back street behind George Square, clutching my chest and gasping for breath, tears stung my eyes as I realised this really was it. I was dying. Accepting my inevitable fate, I looked up through my tears. A dog was taking a massive piss against the wall right in front of me. I watched the terrier's urine wending its way toward me, a meandering torrent of stinking yellow piss. Mesmerised, I could feel my heart grow calm and my breath come more easily. Struggling to my feet to dodge the dog piss, I registered with relief that, in fact, death was not on the cards for me that day. Fate had something very different in store for me. I am 39 years old. 39. I have just bought a house I cannot afford and frankly do not deserve with my long-term girlfriend, Chloe. We have been together for over 8 years. I am a professional stand-up comedian who probably earns less than most 20-somethings when they graduate. I have no real concept of responsibility other than the legal requirement to pay my utility bills and phone my mother. I frequently fail at both of these. I am 39 years of age. 39. You got that? I have no savings, career prospects, or security of any kind. And in just 1 month's time, 4 weeks away from this near-death experience in a dog piss alley in Edinburgh Old Town, I am to become a parent. I have no real understanding of just how much my life is about to change. I failed my adult responsibility test, but have a PhD in arrested development, and I am almost certainly not emotionally equipped to parent anything, not even a hamster. I feel sorry for 39-year-old me. Chapter 1. Before. How did I get to be such a late bloomer and all-round permanent adolescent? You may well ask. I do, often. Before we go any further, we need to go back. 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 If this was TV, at this point there'd be some eerie music and a blurry sepia tinge to let you know we're going on a flashback. But this is an audiobook, so you'll just have to use your imagination. To understand how I got here with my PhD in arrested development, we need to take a look at the young Jen Brister. I grew up in a suburb of southwest London with my Spanish mum, my English dad, and my three brothers. I was number 2 of 4 and a tomboy. I basically wanted to be like my brothers, i.e. a boy. You can imagine how delighted my mum was when her only daughter refused all the trappings that you would expect a young girl to enjoy. Care Bears, Cindy dolls, My Little Pony, dresses, even the Girls' World styling head left me cold. I was much happier up a tree, kicking a football about or playing bundles with my brothers. Bundles, a game in which three of us hurled ourselves on top of the fourth. It was a lot of fun, unless you were the person underneath. I quite liked primary school. It was a mixed school with more boys than girls. I had two best friends, neither of whom were much into the girly stuff either. Secondary school, however, for me, was like being in prison. I hated it. It was an all-girls Catholic convent school in Wimbledon. I liked the learning bit, but there always seems to be more emphasis on telling you what you couldn't do rather than on what you could. I spent most of my time being given detention for having an attitude, which made no sense to me. Surely everyone has an attitude. If you don't have an attitude, how can you have any opinions or viewpoints on anything? Isn't that something the school should be striving towards? More children with attitudes? Apparently not. Detention for me, again. In many ways, I was a complete idiot. In other ways, I was just a lonely, flat-chested adolescent trapped so deep in the closet I might as well have moved permanently to Narnia and taken up the panpipes. As a long-term closet resident, self-awareness wasn't my strong point. I had about as much of that as an X Factor contestant murdering a Whitney Houston ballad in one of those worst auditions of all time montages. That said, I'd always known, even from a very young age, that I wanted to be a mum. Which was confusing because I also knew that I really didn't want to have sex with a man. It seems absurd now, as someone who is clearly a massive lesbo, that I ever thought that shagging a bloke could be an option for me. But let's not forget that this was the 80s, and things couldn't have been more binary. If you were a bloke, then you got with a woman, and vice versa. No one was talking about being gender fluid, non-binary or trans. Even if you were overtly gay, people thought you were just a bit flamboyant. Let's not forget that there is a generation of people who still can't get their head round the fact that Liberace was gay. What straight man doesn't like Cuban heels, Diamante dinner jackets and cock? It's not like gay people were completely invisible in the 80s. It's just that most people, at best, didn't want to acknowledge them, and at worst, didn't like them. I honestly don't know how Boy George survived that decade. So, as an adolescent at an all-girls convent school, regardless of my personal preferences, when I envisaged my future, it was with a man. When I look back at my younger self now, I find it incredible that knowing I was gay and being gay wasn't enough for me to actually come out as gay. The years I wasted trying to like boys. Internalised homophobia is a truly powerful thing. I even went on a few dates, none of which ever progressed to a second, two of which stand out in particular, probably because they were so horrific. One guy took me fishing. I say fishing. He took me to the bank of the Thames where I watched him fish. For anyone who has ever been fishing, you'll know that nothing happens. After being bored out of my mind watching him run his fingers through a bucket of maggots for 2 hours, he went in for a kiss. I panicked and punched him in the chest, causing him to step backwards into the river. You may judge my reaction a tad harsh, but the guy was wearing Wellington boots on a date. My last ever date with a boy was when I was 15. He was in the sixth form, which made him glamorous. Slightly less glamorous was his idea of a great night out. He took me to McDonald's because he had two sets of vouchers for a McChicken sandwich and a lemonade. If I was lucky, maybe he'd buy me a side order of regular fries. I never saw the fries, but later that afternoon I did get to watch him play Double Dragon for 2 hours in a kebab shop in New Malden. Someone shoot me in the face. I gave up any attempt at cultivating a liking for boys after that, but I still had no real understanding about lesbians. There just weren't any around, either in my life or on TV. In fact, the only film I'd ever seen involving any lesbians was The Killing of Sister George. And frankly, the image of the terrifyingly predatory and drunk Beryl Reed in her bosomy tweeds wasn't much help on the les a role model front. If you're not represented by the media and have never met anyone like you, then you start to think that you might be the only one. After all, none of my friends seemed to be questioning who they were attracted to or whether or not it was normal to fancy Stephanie Powers in Heart to Heart and Linda Carter's Wonder Woman and Lisa Stoddart and Julie Wilson and Claire Bright and Hannah Ainsworth and that girl with a ponytail 2 years above me and that girl that worked in a cafe on Kingston High Street. Oh God, all teenage girls fancy girls, don't they? Time went on. I left school. I went to university. I was happy enough with my life, but I was missing certain landmarks. Unsurprisingly, I never had a boyfriend. In fact, I couldn't imagine having a relationship with anyone. It seemed like something other people did. But I knew that I wanted children. Even as a single, closeted 20-something, I continued to have dreams about being a mum. In one dream, I gave birth to a baby girl. She just slipped out. It was a dream, okay? I felt an intense love for this tiny daughter. But after a short while, I noticed that something wasn't quite right. She was slightly deformed. I turned to my mum in the dream and said, "Mum, one of her bum cheeks is bigger than the other." My mother looked at me and said, "Don't worry, it will drop eventually." What can I say? I like cheese before bedtime. In real life, there was a quandary as to how I could get pregnant without having any actual involvement with a man. How did I imagine these children would arrive? By carrier pigeon? What's more, I have no idea how I thought I could possibly have taken responsibility for raising a child back then. I couldn't even take responsibility for myself. My 20s were a chaotic and directionless mess. I look at 20-somethings now who seem so together and level-headed and I think, how do you know what you're doing? I spent 12 years bouncing from one job I hated to another, with no plan for the future. I didn't get my shit together even after I came out of my oh-so-cozy closet. Yeah, I know. You'd think that was the problem. And maybe it was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.